Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Q4 FY24 results conference call of Mahanagar Gas Limited, hosted by Emkay Global Financial Services. As a reminder, all participants' lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions at the end of today's presentation. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star, then zero on your touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Sabri Hazarika from Emkay Global Financial Services. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon. On behalf of Emkay Global, I'd like to welcome you all to the Q4 FY24 post-earnings conference call of Mahanagar Gas Limited. We are pleased to have the top management from the company, led by Mr. Ashu Singhal, Managing Director, Mr. Sanjay Shende, Deputy Managing Director, Mr. Rajesh Patel, Chief Financial Officer, and Mr. Rajesh Wagle, Senior Vice President, Marketing. Before we start, I'd just like to read the disclaimer on behalf of the company. So I'd like to mention that some of the statements made in today's discussion may be forward-looking in the nature, and we believe that expectations contained in the statement are reasonable. However, these statements involve a number of risks and uncertainties that may lead to different results. The risks related to these statements are included but not limited to fluctuations of sales volume, foreign exchange, and the cost of ability to manage the growth. We urge you to consider that quarterly numbers are not a reflection of long-term trends or indication of full-year results. This should not be attempted to be extrapolated or interpolated into a full-year number. In case of any queries, please feel free to get in touch with the Ernst & Young Investor Relations team. With that said, so just wanted to say that today's session will be an opening remarks by the management and followed by the question and answer round. So I now hand over the call to the management. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, very good afternoon to all of you. First of all, on behalf of management of Mahanagar Gas, I wish all of you a very happy Akshay Tritiya. And just to put on record, Mr. Sanjay Shinde, the Deputy Managing Director, is not here today. So it is being attended by other three members from the management. So good afternoon and welcome to earnings call of Mahanagar Gas for the fourth quarter of the financial year 23-24. I would like to thank all of you for attending our earnings call today. I take this opportunity to highlight few accomplishments during this financial year. We have commissioned 36 new CNG stations and upgraded 45 existing CNG stations, which is the highest number achieved by the company in the history of the company. We have provided 320,125 domestic PNG connections, and along with our subsidiary Unison Enviro, we have completed 330,000, which is highest in the country by any CGD entity. We have completed acquisition of 100% stake in Unison Enviro Private Limited and is now wholly owned subsidiary of Mahanagar Gas. We have started the JV company Mahanagar LNG Private Limited with 51% equity holding for supplying LNG to vehicles and a step towards developing the supply side LNG corridor ecosystem. We have also have made an equity investment in 3 EV Industries Private Limited, a startup in the business of manufacturing three-wheeler cargo and passenger electric vehicles. And also, they have a business of last-mile mobility through their associate company. MGLS signed MOU with MCGM for setting up of a CBG plant in Mumbai. We have achieved highest volume of sales, which is 3.609 MMSCMD. MGL continues to create CGD infrastructure across its licensed areas. During this quarter, we have achieved 117,279 domestic household connections, and thus we have established connectivity for nearly 2.49 million households in the 3 GAs. We have also laid 226.04 kilometers of steel and PE pipelines during this quarter, thereby taking the aggregated pipeline length to 6968 kilometers. We have added 28 CNG stations during the quarter, and with this, we have 347 CNG stations as on 31st March 24. We also have added 108 industrial and commercial customers during this quarter, and thus as on 31st March 24, we have 4769 industrial and commercial customers. In respect of our RAGR GA, we are connected to 80,041 domestic households and 47 CNG stations, and are currently operational, which are currently under operation. During the quarter, we laid 13 kilometers of pipeline in Raigarh GA, thereby taking the total length of pipeline to 416 kilometers in Raigarh. Coming to MGL's operations, average sales volume for the year is 3.609 MMSCMD, whereas it was 3.423 MMSCMD in the last year. Thus, there is an increase of 5.45% in the overall sales volume compared to previous year. Average sales volume for the year ended 31st March 24 of 3.609 consists of CNG volume of 2.549, domestic volume of 0.52, and industrial and commercial volume of 0.499 MMSCMD. Compared to the previous years, sales volume in case of CNG has increased from 2.492 to 2.591 MMSCMD, which is an increase of 3.98%. Domestic PNG sales volume has also increased from 0.487 to 0.58, which is an increase of 6.72%. And in case of INC, volume has increased from 0.444 to 0.499 MMSCMD, which is an increase of 12.32%. Coming to quarter-on-quarter comparison, average sales volume of Q4 is 3.779 MMSCMD as compared to previous quarter of 3.671. Such average sales volume of 3.779 consists of CNG volume of 2.666, domestic PNG volume of 0.563, and INC volume of 0.55 MMSCMD. EBITDA for the financial year is ₹1,843 crore compared to previous financial year of EBITDA of ₹1,184 crore, which is an increase of 56%. Net PAT for the current financial year for FY23-24 is ₹1,289 crore compared to net PAT for the previous financial year of ₹790 crore, which is an increase of 63%. Net PAT for the quarter is ₹265 crore as compared to previous quarter net PAT of ₹317 crore. In consolidated results, operation for 2 months of Unison Enviro Private Limited are included from the date of acquiring control, that is from 1st of February to 31st March 24. Mahanagar LNG Private Limited has started its construction activities and yet to start the sales operation as on 31st March 24. We continue our initiatives in environment safety and CSR activities. During this quarter, MGL has bestowed with the second prize of 18th CII Western Region HSC Awards and in Acceleration Innovation Award 2024. I'm happy to announce that Board of Directors has proposed a final dividend of Rs. 18 per equity share for the financial year 23-24. Thus, total dividend for the year, including interim dividend already paid, is Rs. 30 per share. That is 300% of the face value of Rs. 10 per equity share. With this, I will conclude my opening remarks and would now like to open the floor for questions. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and 1 on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and 2. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Probal Sen from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. Good afternoon, sir. I had a couple of questions. Firstly, in terms of the cost seen in this quarter, there seems to be a sudden increase in the operating expenditure in the sense that other OPEX has gone up very sharply, and OPEX per SCM is also probably the highest we've seen in the last 6 quarters. I just wanted to understand the reasons for the same.
In line with the volumes increasing, some of the volume-linked expenses have certainly gone up, like power and fuel, LCV, transportation, dispensing charges, etc. And in case of fixed overheads, some of these expenses have gone up. Mainly, there is an increase on account of the marketing schemes introduced for promotion of CNG vehicles. So almost more than 25 crore has been spent during the quarter on account of these marketing schemes, which is the main component of, you know, comparative increase from around 168 crore in the previous quarter to around 192 crore this year. So this is a kind of one-time expenditure, and we have, you know, finished with this scheme at the moment as of March. Okay. So this is not ongoing or a recurring expenditure, a 25 crore odd amount.
So as a recurring number, so we should continue to take around basically the 5.9 to around 6, which is an SCM kind of a range, adjusted, of course, for inflation impact. Is that a fair way to look at it?
I'm not able to get your number. You are saying 9 to the, what OPEX per SCM you are referring to, or what is it?
Yeah, OPEX per SCM, sir. If I look at the average, for example, till about Q4 for the last several quarters, was it somewhere around 5.7 to 5.8 rupees per SCM?
So there
could be raw material costs.
Understood. Yeah. So there could be a one-time increase of around, you know, 20-25 paise on account of these schemes and certain things. Also in Q4, you know, some of the expenses on account of maintenance, etc., are taken up, which is slightly lower in earlier quarter because most of the thing starts after October and then it gets finished by the year end or mid of May, which is a construction season. Apart from that, let's say whatever is the spending on account of CSR expenses. Those are also, if there is something unspent which gets booked in the last quarter. So all this put together may be accounting for around, you know, 20-25 paise, OPEX higher. Of course, but the marketing expenses are one of its kind, and depending on how frequently we take up such activity, it could be there. Otherwise, it may not impact the OPEX as such on an ongoing basis.
Understood. The second question was with respect to the gas cost. Just wanted to know what was the priority gas allocation as a percentage this quarter, and is that the primary reason why there is a QOQ increase in the gas cost per unit? Is that a fair way to look at it?
Yeah. In this quarter, on an average, we have been able to get around 74% APM compared to our sales in the priority sector. But with the availability of HPHT, I think still the weighted average has remained well under control in the range of around, let's say, 7.25 or 7.3 MMBTU per dollar.
Right. And going forward, sir, basically, if I can get a sense, well, you know, in terms of the sourcing mix now, given that volumes will also increase by maybe around, at the guidance given, 5.5-6%, will we need to source basically higher spot LNG, given the trend in this lower, you know, consistently declining allocation?
You are right. Maybe spot, or it could be through some term contracts. As of now, we have, you know, almost 0.75 odd Henry Hub contract, which we are not utilizing completely for our INC requirement. So we are in a comfortable position, and this gas we can draw up to, if we draw up to 100%, we can use Henry Hub also. And as you are aware, currently I think spot prices are quite comfortable and maybe sometimes lower than even HPHT. So we try and blend even spot if possible to the extent of whatever term contracts we can ram down. Okay. So yes, you're right that, you know, if there is a 5-6% growth and if there is no increase in APM, of course in the first quarter there was I think temporary issue from ONGC side whereby the production was down. Initially, some more cut was there, and it was again restored by, you know, some percentage. So, depending on how much is the production from ONGC, balance will have to be sourced through HPHT and either term contracts or spot. Yeah.
Sir, one last question or suggestion, if I may. If I look at the kind of improvement that's happening in terms of our cash flows, in terms of our operating cash flows, and in terms of our free cash flow, you know, there is a lot of leeway in terms of either increasing dividend or looking at more substantial acquisitions itself. Just wanted your thoughts of how the management is looking at capital deployment, because the danger is with this kind of surplus cash flow getting generated, your return ratios can see a little bit of moderation. You know, enough capital deployment avenue is not there. Just your thoughts on that will be appreciated. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah, your observation is very correct. If you look at, you know, this year, whole year, our surplus would have been in the range of 2,000 crore plus. But today, my surplus is in the range of 1,400-1,500 crore. Around, you know, 560 crores we have spent on acquisition of Unison Enviro. Another 50 crore we have invested in this company called 3V Industries Private Limited, which is into manufacturing of three-wheeler cargo and passenger vehicles. Some amount of capex or equity infusion we have done in the new joint venture which we have formed for catering to, you know, LNG supply to the vehicles. Okay. And of course, we have planned the and we have signed the MOU with MCGM for setting up the CBG plant, where we expect at least, you know, 100 crore plus of equity infusion. But of course, it will be in phase manner. Having said that, you must have also heard that MD said this year the dividend, final dividend, which is at rupees 18. So total dividend for the year is 30 rupees per share, 300%. Which is a substantial increase compared to the last year. We had given 26 rupees total dividend last year. We have so increased it almost by 40%. Okay. And as far as new opportunities are concerned, we are, you know, keeping the tab, and let's see as and when there is a suitable opportunity. So all endeavor is there to deploy our surplus cash to either diversify and make the existing, you know, business more this. We have also incurred this year a capex of almost 775 crore, okay, and our endeavor is to spend more. If you heard the number of stations laid, we have achieved, I think, highest station in this year, 36 stations, 45 stations are upgraded, number of connections given are also highest. So our endeavor is to spend more and more capex going forward and utilize our surplus to, you know, tap the balance potential in the these areas. Going forward, also in the case of UEPL, currently also what we have done is we have repaid their borrowing by giving unsecured loan from MGL to the extent of 200 crore. And we would be funding them at least for 2-3 years till they start accruing cash, and which is being utilized for their own capex through internal generation. So there also we expect that around 150-200 crore will be utilized, apart from MGL capex, which is already in the range of 800 crores per annum. Okay.
Right.
So right. I think all efforts are being made to see that, you know, we do the capital investment and go ahead, use the surplus as far as possible. Okay. Other options, I think, we may consider if need be. We are open to all those options.
Understood, sir. Thank you so much for the detailed answer. Appreciate it. I'll come back in the queue.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Niharika from Equitas Investment. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah, ma'am, please go ahead.
Yeah. My first question is, what is the breakup of the intangible asset of 520 crores in the consolidated balance sheet? And this is over and above the goodwill of 71 crores.
520, okay,
consolidated.
See, as per the accounting standards, there is a timeline of 1 year for accounting the acquisitions, okay? So currently, whatever accounting we have done is a provisional accounting based on the valuation report which we have received from the valuer. See, we have acquired this company, or we got the control on 1st of February, so hardly 2 months. So during that period, the valuer has visited all the assets and they have submitted their valuation report. So whatever numbers are being now accounted are provisional, and we will be coming up with the actual numbers based on the final report which the management accepts from the valuer, and the valuer is able to finalize. You need any specific information with respect to valuation?
Currently accounted? Assets, actually. I would want to know that.
Sorry?
What are these intangible assets? Are these the geographic
areas? So major intangible asset in case of a CGD entity is basically valuation of the authorization. Okay?
Okay. Okay.
Apart from that, it is a normal case with any other business which we acquire. So like it is, you know, customer relations, the established form of workforce, and the structure or the ongoing business which generates a normal goodwill. So other than goodwill, the major amount is on account of license authorization, which is accounted as intangible.
And in this license, we get the right to market the gas to all the customers, including CNG, PNG, and INC for the economic life of the whole project and the whole 3GA. So if you take into that account, that numbers are currently given as intangible assets.
Okay. Got it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Yogesh Patil from Dolat Capital. Please go ahead.
Thanks for giving me an opportunity, sir. Sir, you just mentioned that total term contracts are of 7.75 MMSCMD. Can you please provide the breakup in terms of how much is Henry Hub, Brent Link, and the KGD6 HPHT?
So I just mentioned 0.75 is a Henry Hub. Around 0.1 is our Brent Link, okay? And roughly 0.49 or 5 is HPHT term contracts. These are the three term contracts currently we have.
And 0.75 we are not utilizing completely.
Yes, because that was currently our requirement is slightly lower than that.
Okay. Sir, second question, vehicle addition details. How many CNG vehicle additions you have noticed in Q4 and how many of them are passenger vehicles, commercial vehicles, taxis and auto rickshaws? Along with this, if you could share the MSRTC CNG bus additions in the last 3 months and expected additions in the next 6 months?
The CNG vehicle addition in Q4 was slightly more than 20,000 numbers, out of which about 13,000 were private cars. About 5,400 were auto rickshaws, and about 1,400 were small commercial vehicles. As regards MSRTC, they have succeeded in converting and bringing on the road 300 of their buses cumulatively in our GAs, in the depots where we have set up our CNG facilities. And we are expecting 100 more to add on in the next one or two quarters.
Okay. Sir, one question related to volume. Your company has stop providing CNG discount coupons from 1st Jan 2024 for the passenger vehicles. And we see quarter-on-quarter CNG volume growth is quite muted in Q4. So is this the right way to analyze the muted growth over quarter-on-quarter for the CNG? Or is there any reason Q-on-Q growth for the CNG volume is only 1%?
Just to put you the schemes, marketing schemes in right perspective, it was not a discount on CNG. It was a scheme where a person buys a car, we were giving 20,000 worth of, you know, gas coupon, and he can use it for filling those coupons for at our stations. So that was not a discount on the CNG sale as such. Okay.
But, you know, having said that, the total numbers of vehicles which added, these were passenger vehicles, which were added in Q3 or Q4 for that matter, was between 13 and 15,000. Now, this is on a base of almost 9-10 lakh vehicles. And these private cars, the per capita consumption is relatively lower. So, it may not be correct to attribute the, you know, stoppage of giving this to 20,000 incentive from 1st Jan onwards to any muted CNG growth, because CNG growth drivers, major drivers, you know, is not incremental passenger cars in a way. It is coming from how the existing large customer base is using CNG. What is their per capita fill moving like, and how much they are consuming?
To that, I would just like to add, Yogesh, if you look at, you know, my numbers traditionally also, Q3 is generally good and there is slightly seasonality, and volumes are lower or the increase is not that high in Q4. So though there is a net increase from Q3 to Q4, because of seasonality, the volume increase or the vehicle addition which has happened is not getting reflected correctly in the volumes clocked for Q4. If you look at even last year, my Q3 volumes were around 2.47, whereas Q4 was 2.41. So this year, there is a net increase, which is actually because of the addition of these vehicles. It will get, you know, showing results in the quarters going forward.
Okay. And the last one, your company completed the acquisition of 3 new GAs in February. So the volume of these 3 GAs are included in the reported volume, which we reported 3.79 MMSCMD. Please correct me if I'm wrong on this side.
No, it is excluding those volumes. The metrics which was given in the stock exchanges was only for the standalone, if you see the paper. Okay, and the numbers which MD discussed were all in the speech were also only standalone MGL. But just to give you the information on UEPL volume, UEPL has clocked around 1.4 MMSCMD volume in the quarter. 0.14, 140,000 volumes in the quarter four as an average, on an average.
Okay, thank you very much, and I wish you the best luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kirtan Mehta from BOB Capital Markets. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for the opportunity. Just wanted to understand more about the volume growth. From the 25 crore scheme expense that we have done this time, what is the translation of the benefit in terms of the number of vehicle additions? And was it primarily for the MHCV segment where we have spent this in way? Incentives?
What segment you said?
Yeah, the commercial vehicle segment.
Commercial vehicle, yeah.
Well, if you look at the commercial goods vehicle segment, and if you exclude the, you know, the very small commercial vehicles and talk of only above 1 ton kind of a range, we have been witnessing a pretty good percentage growth in the numbers, you know, pursuant to the scheme. However, on an absolute basis, that has not really, you know, started to move the needle on the overall CNG sale yet. We expect it to take a few more, you know, quarters and for these numbers to really hit a level where they will start materially moving CNG volumes. I mean, just to give an example of for trucks, etc., we were doing a negligible amount of, you know, additional trucks every quarter, but then Q3 we managed to do 67, Q4 97. So traction is coming, and along with the OEs, we are you know, pushing transporters, fleet owners, etc., to adopt more and more CNG.
Understood about the commercial scheme. In terms of the 25 crore that you spent, which segments were it spent on?
It was both passenger car vehicle cars with Maruti and Honda, etc., as well as OE fitted commercial goods vehicles from Ashok Leyland, Tata Motors, Volvo Aisha, etc., as well as with two parties who were retrofitting commercial goods vehicles and two parties who are retrofitting private cars. So this is a combination of all this is about that 25 odd crores.
Just, I'm slightly confused. So the way we said is that from the 1st of January, we have stopped sort of issuing the discount coupon on the passenger vehicles.
But passenger vehicle we have stopped. We have not stopped the commercial goods vehicles.
So the expense that we have booked from 167 to 192 crore in Q4, does it still relate to the past bookings that we have done in the passenger vehicle?
No. Nothing of the past quarter. But yes, apart from the schemes, we have also done some amount of advertising in media, television, and maybe on newspapers and highways. That also is included in this 25 crore.
Right.
As a CNG drive, PNG drive, if you see and look at the bus stops, some of the highways, there has been a good amount of advertisement, and as well as on the radios we have done. It includes some amount of PNG promotion as well.
And do we intend to continue with this promotion, or do we like to sort of stop at this point and see the benefit?
We have been discussing this with the vehicle manufacturers. What we are getting from them is saying that, you know, promotional schemes have to be intermittent. You know, they cannot drag on for a long time. Otherwise, the urgency and, you know, the imminent sense of, you know, that the customer has to feel that, okay, if I don't buy now, you know, maybe after 2 months, I will not get this opportunity. So that angle goes away if you have it in a long stretch. So that is why we decided jointly to give a break. As and when the time is appropriate, we will again engage with the passenger car vehicle manufacturers to re-engage. But however, in the commercial goods segment, there we are seeing a good case for, you know, continuing our promotions, because the value proposition also for us is very high, and those numbers are relatively small. It is more of, you know, B2B catching hold of transporters, you know, convincing them, where this delta of, you know, 3 lakh or 5 lakhs which you pitch in with, and the OE also pitches in with something from his side, that makes a good difference. So from literally zero adoption, we have moved to now a few hundreds coming on, adding on every month or so. Whereas in, if you look at the passenger car vehicles, the delta from the schemes has not really been that much. I mean, maybe 10% or 20% we might have got, but in the commercial goods vehicles, the percentage increase is very high.
Understood. Just similar thing on the industrial and commercial side, our volume have increased from 0.45 a year ago to 0.55. So what has been the driver for this increase, and how can it, how do we extrapolate this in the future?
So the drivers for this, I think we had mentioned earlier also, there were some key pricing policy interventions which we took about a year, year and a half back, in which we almost guaranteed all new customers, large new customers, of a 10% discount to FO for 3 years if they used our gas. Now, that guaranteed 10% discount, you know, enabled us to sign up more than 1 lakh SCMD worth of new contracts, and many of those have now come on stream. So that is where you're seeing a roughly 12% increase in volumes in I&C. As on date, we have another 1 lakh SCMD worth of industrial contracts, which we will be connecting in the coming year, after the, you know, the construction season starts in October, November. So maybe Q3, Q4, those fellows will add. One or two may add on in the next
by May.
By May, June. And we are expecting to see double-digit growth in the I&C segment in this financial year also.
Right, sir. Thanks for this clarification. I will get back in the queue.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vivekanand Subraman from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity. Can you explain to us the commissions that you are paying to the OMCs for hosting, for the sale of CNG through their outlets? That's question one. Secondly, you have commitments to invest in CBG. When is your first plant coming on stream, and what's the potential that you're looking at in terms of substituting your current sourcing of either HPHT gas or RLNG with CBG over the next 3 years? Thank you.
Answer to your first question with respect to OMC trade margins. See, the trade margins are decided based on the class of city they are having the stations with us. So for metro city, the commission is in the range of around 5 rupees 40 paise per kg. And depending on the other class of city, class A, B, C, it goes down as low as around 4 rupees 60 paise. And in C class city, it goes to around 3 rupees 70 paise per kg. So this is the range depending on where is the station located of oil marketing company.
Regarding the CBG plant, we have signed an MOU with BMC, and still our board has also approved the investment proposal. Now we are waiting for the land to be get in our position, and once we get the position of the land, it will take around 1.5 years to get the plant running and commissioning. The quantity is not very high. I mean, it is around 30 tons per day for 500 TPD plants, so around 55 to 60 tons of CBG will be produced, which is around equivalent to around 70,000 SCMD, which is not a very significant number considering our whole volumes of 3.6 MMSCMD, that is 36 lakhs cubic meter per day. So that's a very small number. It will be maybe consumed during the growth of the company year on year.
Okay. And just one follow-up on the trade margins to MCs. Is there still any dispute between the industry, the CGD sector, and the OMCs on trade margins, or have those issues been resolved already?
There were some discussions going on. We have, this continuous engagement with OMCs, and as a matter of this discussion, ministry also was getting involved for some time, and they have issued some broad guidelines as all India basis. So there is no dispute as such, barring that for an interim period of 1.5 years, the numbers are yet to be frozen, which are getting negotiated with the OMCs, which we expect that will be resolved in few months' time.
Okay, thank you, and all the best.
To add, there is no impact as such of such things on financials, because we have been adequately providing all those estimates, if any.
Provisions have also been created in the accounts.
Sorry, just to follow up further. So, are you paying currently less than the amounts you mentioned, and is there any amount that you are providing for but not yet paying?
No. As MD said, we have already settled for the current period, and it is being paid at the rates agreed. But some period in between, intermittent in the past, there is some settlement still pending and negotiations are on, and which I'm saying are adequately provided by us.
Okay, how much is that amount?
I think I can't put that amount. Okay.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
Not very significant.
Not significant, not possible to quantify accurately also at this point in time.
Understood.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, you may press star and one to ask questions. The next question is from the line of S. Ramesh from Nirmal Bank Equities. Please go ahead.
Good evening and thank you very much. So if you look at your consolidated results and try to break it up, I get a revenue of around 56 crores and loss of 12 crores before tax and a gross contribution of 31 crores. Presumably for the Unison Enviro, and the gross margin seems to be very high. We just take February, March volumes on that 0.14 run rate. So can you give us some sense in terms of what is the aggregate volume UNIL has done for February, March in the consolidation, and what is the gross margin, and when you expect to, turn around this PBT loss to EBITDA positive? We don't know whether the EBITDA is positive, yeah, positive gross margin. So what is the reading in terms of how much this can grow in FY25-26? And what is the kind of EBITDA run rate you can expect, say, over the next 2 years? And when you expect to see, positive profits at the pre-tax level?
Mr. Ramesh, there are, two things. When you consolidate the results, there is certainly some impact of the valuation and the values which are attributable to license. Those are also amortized. So straight away, you can't compare the standalone entity's result by minusing the consolidated results of MGL. Okay. So there are some charge which are non-cash charge which are appearing in the consolidated results, and hence you see a gap of whatever number you said, around 12 crores. Okay. Just to confirm, on an annual basis, as earlier also we have said, Unison is a EBITDA positive company. And currently they are making around 60 crores EBITDA per annum. That is a range. And as I said, average sales is in the range of 1,40,000 MMSCMD. Sorry, 1,40,000 is cubic meter, or 0.14 MMSCMD.
So, and how do you see that growing in the next 2 years in terms of percentage growth?
See, all new CGDs have a better growth, and our endeavor is to, connect, put up the pipelines and connect most of the stations. Currently, they are having most of the stations out of 55 odd stations, almost only four stations are online, four or five. So as soon as we are able to connect through pipeline, the throughput per station will go up. Apart from that, our endeavor is to put up more stations to capture the volumes in those areas. As we have said earlier also in the call, that as per our estimate, the overall terminal volumes which can be achieved over 7-8 years are in the range of 1.2 MMSCMD. And gradually, I think it should be a double-digit growth if you are able to, you know, put up these stations and convert some of the existing stations into this DBS to online, and also some of the industrial and domestic potentials in these three GAs.
See, we have recently taken over the company, and we have aggressive plan for both CapEx and also looking into the way the business is being conducted there. So as CFO mentioned, we expect that the growth will be in double digits in terms of volume, and we want to capture both CNG volume, which is the main profit, and the volume with revenue generating from the Unison. Plus industry and commercial in some of the sectors in Ratnagiri also we are targeting. So we expect that growth will continue, and with the aggressive plan in the CapEx, the results will start coming in from maybe next financial year.
Okay. Is it possible to quantify these non-cash charges in consolidation on a broad order of magnitude basis?
Sir, at this moment, I think it will not be really appropriate to do that, because as I said earlier, we have accounted this intangible on the provisional basis, because the accounting standards permits us almost a period of 1 year and then freeze the valuation. Also, in these 2 months, you know, some of the one-time expenditures which are spent for, you know, obtaining the transfer from PNGRB and then other management consultancy expenses for doing this deal, apart from the notional valuation charge which might have gone in the consolidated profit and loss account. When you see the full year on or full quarter on expenses, I mean results, you will get a better feel of the results. I think 2 months is a period. Also, you know, a lot of realignment of MGL policy and their policy we have done. So we have taken some credits also in this consolidated result. So once you see the first quarter, we will be able to, you know, see properly what is standalone UEPL as such. Okay.
So one more thought. Now, in terms of your growth for the next 4 to 8 quarters, is it fair to assume that your industrial and commercial may possibly grow faster than CNG, given the kind of trend we are seeing? That's what we hear from other companies. And secondly, can you give us some sense in terms of how you see the commercials for LNG retailing move in terms of the discount versus diesel, and how you see the vehicle additions there? What is the roadmap there?
On your first question, yes, for the next 4 to 8 quarters, we expect the industrial and commercial sales volumes to grow in double digits, which will be more than CNG or domestic PNG. And as regards, you know, you're asking about the
LNG prices are slightly discount to diesel. Right now, to promote the industry, we have recently commissioned our Sabroli station last year. So we are also promoting the sale in terms of getting more contracts there. So we have developed a fixed margin on our cost plus basis and trying to promote this as a product in substitute to diesel. So as of now, we are selling around 4 tons per day of LNG from that station on an average basis, which has picked up over the last few months, and we expect that this financial year it will be much better.
Any sense you can give in terms of how you see that growing, say, in the next 2 years, 3 years?
See, the, another point is that we have already established a joint venture company with Baidyanath LNG with 51-49 equity investments. So first station is expected to be commissioned from that joint venture in 1 month's time. And during the year, we are expected to add another 4 stations during this financial year. So the volumes will pick up from Sabroli because that station is more or less established. For this joint venture company, also some volume will start picking up during this financial year. So, I mean, the capacity of the station is around 20 tons per day, but that,
not 20 tons per day?
Yeah.
Tank size, sorry.
So it will fill up around 10-15 tons per day. So we are at average sale of 4 tons, and it can go up during the financial year. And we expect 2-3 quarters down the line, it would increase.
Thank you very much and wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nitin Tiwari from Philip Capital. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. Just a few bookkeeping questions. So if you can help me with the CNG sales in KG and also the breakup of industrial and commercial sales in respective industrial and commercial segments. Thirdly, like, if you can give the breakup of total number of INC customers that you mentioned between industrial and commercial customers. So that would be all.
In terms of KG, for Q4, we have sold around 1.94 million KGs. Okay. Coming to, you wanted INC volume separately, correct?
Correct.
In industry, we have sold around 0.418 MMSCMD. Okay.
Okay.
And other than industry, that is commercial, is roughly 0.14. 142 it is.
Understood. And so a breakup of the number of INC customers between industrial and commercial?
Just a minute. In this quarter,
I suppose the number that you mentioned was 4,769 is the total number of INC consumers that we have, right? So if we can break that in industrial and commercial separately.
Roughly, slightly more than 4,000 would be commercial.
All right.
Industrial should be about 300-400. And we'll get back to the exact number.
Sure, sir. And just wanted to have two clarifications. One on the margin guidance front. So in the previous quarter, we mentioned that we are guiding for a margin of 9 to 11%. So do we maintain that guidance? That's one. And secondly, a clarification on the coupons that you mentioned for basically which were promotional in nature. So have we completely expensed these coupons, or there is also some revenue that would have been booked with respect to CNG sales which will be associated with these coupons getting utilized?
I'm not clear, very clear about the second question. As I said, the person who buys the vehicle, we were giving him the coupon for filling up CNG, okay? So obviously, right. If that coupon is getting utilized on my outlet and the corresponding sale is in my books, so if you look at actual cost to me, let's say if I am selling out, I am giving a coupon of 20,000. So my cost is actually gas cost. But of course, he gets the value which is the MRP of the gas he feels. So let's say somebody has filled up 10 kg of gas and my gas is at 80 rupees, he gets worth rupees 800. Whereas my cost is different because I also make a margin on that particular volume which has gone to him.
Yes, actually, so I was just trying to get a sense around the accounting aspect of this transaction only. So basically, you've given a coupon for 20,000 and the person utilizes the coupon and the gas gets filled. So as you mentioned, like, you know, you are, so basically, no revenue which will be booked against this utilization of gas and it will only...
One-on-one, there is no revenue linkage. It will be coupon cost which will be booked as my marketing expense. And revenue will get booked as and when he utilizes. That I am not supposed to link and see. Though I may track it from the perspective of control that how much was issued and how much has been utilized or unutilized. Okay.
So basically, out of this 20,000, there is some benefit which will accrue to you because of that differential you spoke about between...
Indirectly, it's my profit or gross margin that accrues to the company. Yes.
Understood, sir. And about the EBITDA margin guidance, do we maintain the 9 to 11 rupee per SCM number?
Yes, I think if you look at current year average also, we are quite comfortable. And even if we expect that, you know, some amount of weighted average gas cost going up, but with volume increase, we should have a good control on OPEX once this, initiative of marketing CNG vehicle pays off. So currently average of 13.95 is our EBITDA per SCM. So even if we expect some cost increase and gas costs going up, we are still comfortable with the range of 9 to 11 in the long range, long term, I mean.
Thank you, sir.
The previous question about the breakup of industrial and commercial.
Right.
Out of the 4,700 odd INC customers, 4,300 mm-hmm. roughly are commercial, and 460 odd are industrial.
Thank you so much, sir. That's really helpful, and that answers my question. So I'll get back in the queue.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dhaval Joshi from Damon Asia. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. I'm sorry, I joined in a bit late. If you can just let me know about the volume guidance that you've given for FY25 and 26, volume growth guidance.
We have not talked about the volume growth for this financial year, this 24-25. What we have disclosed was the numbers which we achieved for 23-24 vis-a-vis 22-23. So there is a growth of around 5.5% compared to the last financial year. 3.423 was the overall volume, and this year we have achieved 3.609 MMSCMD.
So how do you see the growth for 25-26 then, sir?
For this 24-25 and next financial year, we expect growth to be slightly better than 5.5%, maybe in the range of 6-7%, or internal targets are more aggressive, but we expect around 5-6% or 6-7% will be the numbers.
And this you're talking purely of CNG or the total volumes, including the industrial and the commercial segment?
This includes both CNG, DPNG and the commercial.
Again, since CNG is almost two-thirds of our volume, or more than 70% in fact, the CNG growth will be very close to this number. We had mentioned that industrial and commercial, we will expect low double-digit growth. The remaining will be DPNG.
Okay. And sir, given right now our margins are lower in the industrial segment, with a higher growth out over there, our margins should be a bit lower on a sequential basis, or do you think, sir, you'll be able to make it up through the CNG sales?
No, your look, margin per SCM may go down, but on absolute term, the margins will go up.
Yes. So I was talking of the margin per SCM.
No, there's a trade-off there, no? Because at a particular selling price level, there is a section of customers who doesn't come on board because FO is cheaper for them.
Okay.
So if you want that volume, you have to take a hit on your margin.
Right.
You can't, get them keeping an 8 rupee or 10 rupee margin. I mean, but if you can always still work with a 4 or 5 rupee margin and get that volume. So overall, in absolute terms, you're gaining. But yes, the percentage increase in volume, as long as that is higher than the percentage decrease in price, I mean, you're good financially.
Secondly, when you look at margins of maybe CNG and domestic on a gross margin level basis, you may feel okay, they are higher than industrial commercial. But when you look at a total OPEX level basis, you incur a lot of, expenses, and more of the facilities are deployed for catering to domestic segment, okay, and CNG segment. So other operating expenses like power and fuel, LCV, this in case of domestic, the billing of the customer, collection and all that is pretty high. So when you include all that operating expenses or overheads in case of the DPNG, and there is a very less amount of, such kind of expenses in case of industrial or commercial customer, where volume consumed is larger per customer. So more or less the margin after adding the respective direct, operating expenses are still comparable or reasonably good.
Okay. Thanks a lot, sir. I'll just repeat, you said 6-7% is what you are guiding in terms of volumes, although your internal targets are much higher. Is for the standalone, right? I'm assuming this is not considering the acquisition.
Yeah, that's right.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address the questions from all the participants, please limit your questions to one per participant. I repeat, please limit your questions to one per participant. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Amit Rastogi from UBS. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for taking my question and for posting a wonderful result on the volume front. Sir, my question pertains to the CNG stations. So we have added historic number of 36 stations this year. So can you guide us like how many stations we can expect to add in the coming years, like FY25 and 26? And when most of these stations came, were they came in first half or if these stations came in second half? And then based on the last two quarters, we are seeing we are posting double-digit growth. So can we expect that we can move to a growth number of 8 to 9% given the strong addition of CNG stations and the past two quarters are coming?
See, the CNG stations, we have, as you have rightly mentioned, we have achieved 36 number, but this year, FY25, we expect to do much better in terms of CNG stations. Maybe more than 50 stations we are targeting to be completing this year. And maybe around 40 to 50, around that number will be for FY26. Regarding the phasing of the stations, typically the working season is limited. We have to get the land and the permissions, and therefore most of the stations get commissioned in Q4 of the financial year. And that the same trend we expect, but it's not that everything will be commissioned in the last quarter of the financial year. Q3 and Q4, we get the numbers which are added on to this.
And sometimes we get a small amount of spillover, which, two, three stations which we somehow missed the target in Q4, they spill over into Q1. So Q1 also, usually we see a bit of small number of stations.
Got it, sir. Thanks, sir. Can we consider 8 to 9% kind of volume growth in the coming quarter? Given that we are already posting
the
volume growth now,
there is always a jump because of industry and commercial last quarter. We could add some more customer, and some more will be added in this Q1 and Q2 of this financial year. The main will has to come from CNG, which is the main thing which needs to push. So overall, considering IC, CNG and PNG, we expect 6 to 7% as mentioned earlier, but we will try to better it.
Sorry, sir. Thank you and best of luck, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Hema Khanna from Nomura. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for taking my question. Firstly, could you please help us get a sense of what will be your CAPEX guidance for FY25, 26 and 27? And the second question is relating to, could you give us the realizations for the industrial and commercial segments individually?
As far as our CAPEX guidance is concerned, though we target, and have an internal budget approval in the range of 900 to 1,000 crore, at least in the next year. This year we have clocked CAPEX of around 775 crore, okay? And the minimum we expect that we should be able to spend that much amount in CAPEX, because we are targeting higher session compared to this year. We are targeting equally domestic connections also higher than what we have done this year. So, with addition of UEPL, we will be spending another maybe 150 to 200 crore in those areas also. Okay, so put together as a group, our CAPEX should touch 1,000 crore or a little more than 1,000 crore. Okay, coming to the margins of industrial commercial, they range, commercial A is a typically, we benchmark our prices to commercial LPG. And in case of industrial and commercial, industry, benchmark it to the alternate fuels like LSHS, FO, LDO. So the price realization depends on the this alternate fuels and the gas costs which I incur for these segments. Okay, if you want to know about what is my realization for this year, it was in the range of gross margin level, at least in the range of 25 rupees to 30 rupees, depending on whether it is a commercial A customer, B customer or C customer. That is the range, and sometimes it has gone down to as low as 12 rupees also. If at times Brent is lower, then I end up selling at a price where margin is lower, specifically when a customer is very large, consuming maybe 10,000, 20,000 cubic meter, then we do give that pricing so that my overall profitability, absolute profit increases, and we get volumes as well.
Got it, sir. Thank you. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Samaya V from Avendus Park. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity, sir. So the first question is the CBG plant that you said. So what would be the capex for that 70,000 volume that you said?
It will be around 550 to 600 crore. There will be two phases, one 500 tons per day of waste handling in phase one and 500 tons per day of waste handling in phase two. Cumulative put together, it will be 550 to 600 CR.
Got it, sir. And this industrial and commercial, where you said where you signed contracts giving at least a 10% discount to FO. So, is there any gas price, because you are linked to Hinti Hub, beyond which this could be probably tough? I just want to understand, is there any hurdle rate on the gas price?
See, the gas price, we are having a portfolio mix of both Henry Hub and other sources of gases. Sometimes shortfall is managed through spot gas also. The margins are different, and we are not exactly matching it with the procurement cost. The procurement is done on a portfolio basis, and the selling is done on the alternate fuel linkage to the industry or the type of commercial customer it is in. Like for commercial, LPG is the target price, and on discount to LPG, we sell industrial LPG, we sell commercial PNG. Industry also, we see the type of customer, and based on the category of customer, we have different pricing structure for maintaining the price range. So it is not directly linked to procurement cost as such.
So one final question, this 0.75 of entry of midterm contracts, this is take or pay, or
that is take or pay, but the take or pay is limited to 60% around of that range, and in the new contract it could be 70 to 80%. So a lot of flexibility is there. That's why we can switch over either from reducing our term contract in some of these contracts and take spot if that makes sense. Otherwise, we may go for full Henry Hub.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sunil Shah from 3PMS. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. Sir, I somehow missed your statement earlier, so just wanted to confirm that. But the acquisition that we have done, where there are those three geographical areas, there are already 55 existing CNG stations in that locality, and majority of them are not online. That the correct sense?
That's right. Around 50 to 55 stations are already functional. Earlier it was 49 plus 7 were added, so around 56 stations are there which are operating in this three geographical areas. Most of them are DBS, that is daughter booster station, and only very few are online stations.
Okay. Sir, so like in any other geographical area where, in Bombay, Thane, Raigad, we have virtual monopoly, it applies to these three new geographical areas as well? Like, we'll be the only supplier over a period of time?
As a matter of policy, it is not only for MGL, it is all industry basis, all India basis. These are not monopolies, actually these are bidded areas. The PNG RB, the regulator, issues the bids, and interested parties or entities, they quote for it, and whosoever gets the highest bid, they get the licensing.
For a 10-year period.
Not 10 years period, it is 25 infrastructure and 8 years marketing exclusivity.
Okay. So one last question. The margin which you stated, 5.4 for Tier 1 cities, could you please repeat those for Tier 1, Tier 2, Tier 3, the final trader margin?
It is 5.41 for metro, that is Delhi and Mumbai. Then 4.68 for other Thane and
class cities.
Then 4.3 and then 3.7.
Thank you very much. Sorry. Please continue. Extremely sorry.
That is 5.4 for metro, that is Mumbai main. Then 4.68 for Thane and otherwise. Then below that it is 4.38 or something. And then 3.7 for...
0 is the last one for...
C-class cities.
Rural and small areas.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, due to time constraint, that was the last question. And I've handed the conference over to the management for closing comments.
So on behalf of MGL management, it is a pleasure that we have good results. I hope the investors are also pleased with the overall financial performance of the company. This has been one of the finest performance by the company in terms of both physical and financial numbers, as you might have noticed. So thank you so much for having a faith in the company and keeping on investing in the company. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of MK Global Financial Services, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines. Thank you.